So what we've seen before is that sum of squares is somewhat of a super algorithm. So you know, it captures linear programming, spectral algorithms, semi-definite programming, various combinatorial algorithms. So and all these wonderful things that are like, you know, like the Gomez-Williamson algorithm, that's kind of was a breakthrough in algorithm design. So this seems like a super super powerful algorithm, but so the question is, maybe it can do anything, you know. So, but it does have its weakness, and the kryptonite to sum of squares is algebra. In fact, even though it, I guess, like Superman, it was born from algebra, and that's its weakness. And there are some things that it cannot do, even things that are arguably not that difficult. Let me give you an example of one such task.
How many pieces are there?
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10.
How? No, count how many here?
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10.
Ah, okay. And Guren, if you wanted to split these pieces between you and Benjamin, can you split them so everyone gets the same number of pieces?
No.
No, but if you wanted to give yourself the same number as Benjamin, so how many would you give yourself?
16.
So can you do it? Why not?
Because there is no same number, right?
Can you try to do it, same number?
No.
Why not?
Because you couldn't do it, but I'm a superhero.
So you see, even small boy with some prompting does know that you cannot split, you know, an odd number of toys into two equal pieces. But the sum of squares algorithm actually thinks you can do it. So Grigoryov proves that for every n, even if n is odd, there exists a pseudo distribution, and a very high degree pseudo distribution. On which this polynomial vanishes, right? Sum xi, I from 0, 1 to n, minus n over 2. So now n over 2, if n is odd, is not an integer. So there is no way you can sum up 0, 1 variables to get to equal n over 2, but sum of squares thinks this is the case. So even though, like, you know, every kid knows that you couldn't do it, sum of squares believes that a partition like that exists. So that's why some I say, you know, that sum of squares believes in unicorns. You know, so it believes you can actually split an odd number of things equally. And we're not going to show this lower bound, but it's not very hard. And maybe eventually a proof of it will magically appear in the lecture notes, courtesy of Pravesh. Sum of squares does have like some excuse. They say, well, you know, okay, it's true that a partition like that doesn't exist, but there is a partition that's almost equal. So I'm not that much off. But here is one thing that maybe sum of squares has not much that much of an excuse. It turns out that there is also a robust lower bound. So for every what Grigoryov showed is that there exists a set of equations that cannot be satisfied, any assignment cannot satisfy more than 51% of them, but sum of squares thinks you can satisfy all of them. So now it's not, there is not as if like there is even a nearly satisfying assignment. And now the excuse of sum of squares that it's not fair, Grigoryov used the dirty trick, and he used the probabilistic method. And I told you even before that basically the Marley principle, which we have relied upon, that it breaks down when that you don't need to worry about every little thing is going to be all right. That breaks down when you see the probabilistic method. And this is somewhat, and Ryan O'Donnell, I think, raised some good points in the discussion, and we might continue this online, and I have some lengthy comments on exactly what it means, but I don't want to get into this philosophy, but it's kind of as a rule of thumb, you see a proof of a statement, if that proof of a statement used union and Chernoff bound, it might have been problematic to become some squares of Sobal. And if that proof were used the type of things that we use all the time, convexity, Cauchy-Schwarz's, Holder's, maybe even Bascom-Lieb, then it seems like things would be okay. And that's kind of like a heuristic. This is not like a law of nature. Okay. So what we're going to talk today about is about limitations of sum of squares, and these are known as integrality gaps. So the idea is that it's an instance where the true maximum, say if it's in a maximization problem, the true maximum is at most S, but sum of squares thinks that that there is an even better assignment that achieves some value C for some C that is bigger than S. And C and S come from completeness and soundness. So we'll start with integrality gaps for degree 2 sum of squares. And then and we'll see that the Humble cycle is already an integrality gap. I'll just say that the Humble cycle is already an integrality gap. Then we'll talk a little bit about the Frege-Schechtmann graph, which is this tight integrality gap. And then talk about, so in the second hour, I want to talk about how you transform hardness to integrality gap and have integrality gaps inspired by NP hardness results. And in the third hour, I want to talk about this ultra weird result of Raghavendra, which somehow does the other way around and takes an integrality gap and makes it into a hardness result. And I'm going to try to mostly focus on the high-level ideas of the proofs, because I assume you all read the lecture notes, and I hope that it can be more interactive and we can talk about what things you understood or you didn't, what parts of the proof you want me to kind of go into more detail. Okay, so any general question before I turn this off and move to the blackboard? Okay. Starting with degree 2 integrality gaps. So let's start with a simple example. We had Cheeger's theorem, or Cheeger's inequality. It's actually, in this setting, it's not even by Cheeger, but by Alon Milman and Dodzhiuk. And this Cheeger inequality says the following thing. If lambda, so the way we say it is the following. If lambda 2 of the Laplacian of the graph of a graph is at most epsilon, then there exists some set S with number of edges going from this set being at most of square root epsilon times the degree times the size of the set. Okay, or you know, let's say the set is at most n over 2. This is basically the same as the definition of expansion that I used before. So so this is Jigger's inequality. And now we show that it's tight. And to show that it's tight, we simply take the cycle. So so if we take the cycle, in the cycle, the n cycle, for every set of, say, if the size of the set is at most n over 2, what we can we guarantee about the number of edges going from S to its complement? In a cycle, what's the minimum number of neighbors that any set has? Two, right? Two. So this is at least two, which is omega of 1 over n times the size of the set. Right? So that's... but on the other hand, in the lecture notes, we kind of work out exactly the eigenvectors of the cycle and show that we get a pseudo distribution. But let me just give you kind of a quick and dirty reason why the cycle. So the claim is that there exists a vector x such that if you look at x transpose LGX, then this is less than O of 1 over n squared. The norm of x squared. Okay, so and x is orthogonal to the all ones. So this basically says that this is a gap in the instance. So this basically says that the second eigenvalue is at most O of 1 over n squared, because the smallest eigenvalue is 0, and this is the all ones, and then this says that there is another one that's at most O of 1 over n squared. And so this basically says that this is really tight. And how do you get this x? It's actually so you can get the exact right x by some sine function, sinus function, or whatever. But one easy way to get such an x is something like this, which actually looks a little bit like a sine function also. Right, so you have like say 0, n, these are the vertices, and this vector will look something like this. Let's call this, say this is 1, this is minus 1, this is plus 1, this is minus 1, and do something like this. So this is n over 2, n over 4. 3 and over 4. Okay, so this is the vector, right? So at coordinate I, this is its value. And now if we look at this, if this is the vector x, it is orthogonal to the all ones because the area above the curve, above the 0, is the same as the area below the 0. And if you, what is x transpose LGX? It's basically sum from I plus 1 xi minus xi plus 1 squared. That's the value of the Laplacian when you do this. So this difference is always like, so this is basically always 1 over n, so the difference between two guys here, right? So you get n times O of 1 over n squared, which is O of 1 over n. And we want to compare this to the norm of x. So the norm of x, what do we want? The norm of x, what do we need for our thing? Do we need an upper bound or a lower bound on the norm of x? We want to show that this is smaller than we need a lower bound on the norm of x. Okay, so low bound on the norm of x, we kind of can take like, you know, about a constant fraction has more than half. So the norm of x is, you know, about omega n times omega 1. Is that the right thing? Yes, I think. Right, the norm of x, x squared is omega of n. So this is basically O of 1 n squared times the norm of x squared, which is what we wanted to prove. Okay? So the cycle is an example that triggers inequalities time. Okay. And it turns out that if you look at the even cycle is not an example that the max cut, the Gomez-Williamson is tight. Do you know why? It's bipartite, right? So there, the max cut value is 1. So definitely it's not, there's no gap. But the odd cycle, the max cut value is 1 minus 1 over n. But you can get a semi-definite degree 2 pseudo-distribution that pretends that the value is like 1 minus 1 over n squared or something like that, or constant over n squared. So, but it's not, will not give you the tight constant for Gomez-Williamson, so that's why we have this. What school is this? I don't even know what the teacher, but they seem to have like a very strong professor.
They don't even need.
What?
There are like switches on the side.
Okay. You either have to be strong or smart. That makes sense, like if you're weak and stupid. So we want to get tight constants. So, and this is this Fege-Shechmann construction, which is a very nice construction, and it's also like teaches us something about where integrality graphs come from. And how they relate to a lot of rich body of mathematics having to do with isoperimetric inequalities. So basically, Fege-Shechmann showed the following thing. There exists a graph G that satisfies the following properties. This property one is completeness. There is a degree 2 pseudo distribution such that under the expectation of the cut of G under this pseudo distribution is roughly this value XGW, which is up to legal of one terms, it's XGW, which is roughly, just to give a sense, doesn't matter exactly what the number is, just to give a sense. But on the other hand, there is a soundness condition that the true max cut is of G is at less than alpha GW times XGW, where alpha GW is some constant smaller than 1, it's a particular constant, which is 0.878. And I should say that if you wanted a poorer constant, you could use NP harness reduction to get some things that are with a worse constant. The point is not really the constant, but the point is getting a tight example forces you to understand this SDP much more than if you don't get a tight example. And And the graph, the way they prove the theorem is they build this graph, which is an infinite graph. And it turns out that it's okay to build an infinite graph because you can subsample it. And so the idea is you first build an infinite graph where the vertices are the all vectors of a unit norm. And then you show that in this graph there is a pseudo-distribution and there is a cut, and then you basically sample a finite number of points and you get if this finite number is large enough, it's like exponential in the dimension, then this will inherit the max cut and the cut value. So I did not prove that. If you actually go and look at the paper, there is some proof to be done here. It's not super trivial, especially if you kind of want the right number of vertices, rather, you know, if you want it to be the exponential with the right exponent, though it doesn't really matter for the theorem as we stated it. But I hope it's kind of believable. So is that point kind of clear what they're doing here? Okay. So this graph has this property that we basically put an edge between two guys. If they're so we put an edge between U and V. If their dot product is this, right? If UV is roughly equal to rho GW, which is like 1 minus 2 x GW, this is going to be roughly minus 0.69, I think, or something like that. And there was a discussion on Piazza. It doesn't really matter if we define this graph as roughly equal or at most, because this is the concentration of measure phenomena. Almost all of the mass, almost all the pairs will have that have dot product at most rho will have dot product very close to being exactly rho. So the reason, in some sense, if you take some Gaussian and you condition on having value say larger than larger than this tail, then because of the Gaussian kind of exponentially decreases, I'm not really showing it very nicely on this figure, almost all of the mass will be in this kind of very narrow band that's very close to the point where you kind of put your bound, right? Because basically everywhere except around the mean, Gaussians have very, very sharp decay. People, please ask me questions. That's why you came here at this moment of the night, and you know, had to deal with the dragons that are guarding the. So. Okay, so basically, the matrix is now going to be basically PSD almost by definition. So the pseudo distribution, so we define actual random variables XV for every vector V, where XV is simply V, G, where G is a random standard Gaussian. Every coordinate of G is a standard Gaussian. And we define it to be half plus half this thing, I think. So it will become, so XV is going to be distributed like a normal with mean half and variance half, or variance one quarter. standard deviation half, which is how it would be if it same thing as a Boolean vector, variable, like as a 0-1 coin. And if we look at this matrix, the moment matrix, the moment matrix of the pseudo distribution, where you put here for coordinate u and v, you put here expectation xu xv, that equals to half times the all ones matrix plus half times this matrix that has the that has here expectation of vg ug, which is basically like the dot product of u and v, the dot product of u and v, maybe multiplied by something, or no, I think it's the dot product of u and v. So basically this is the matrix, and because it's a dot product matrix, it's a Gras matrix, it's PSD. So this is a PSD matrix plus a PSD matrix, we get a PSD matrix. Okay, so this is a valid pseudo distribution, and we want to, and then basically we just want to say, okay, what's the expectation of the cut? So the expectation of the cut, you look at xu minus xv squared, and then you open up everything, and it comes to be half minus half rho gw if u and v are an edge, and then that basically comes to be x gw by this equation. Okay, and then the hard part, which we didn't prove, but luckily even Fagan Schechmann didn't need to prove because that was already proven, is that if you want to maximize the cut in a geometric graph like that, then the best cut is just to take a hyperplane through the origin and cut to both sides. And this is something that kind of intuitively makes sense, but you know, it's actually not trivial to prove, and that was proven by Borel and by Sudakov and Silson, and basically this is the heart of the and this is the heart of this proof. Yes.
Is there a lower bound to the graph?
So what does it mean, a lower bound?
Like, is it always guaranteed that it's even cycle, for example?
So again?
Is it always guaranteed that it's even cycle?
That what is even cycle like for this particular graph? So this is like an infinite. So this, okay, there is an infinite graph, and then we subsample it to get a finite size graph. Mm-hmm. And what we know about this graph is that the actual max cut value will be it will be actually exactly this value. If that's the question, so you mean if this is like a low bounded or.
Is that always guaranteed with the properties of the graph?
So the infinite graph, it's one single graph, and you can kind of compute what the value you get if you cut across the hyperplane, and in some sense you can even see it here. It cuts u and v exactly if the hyperplane falls between these two guys, which happens with probability, the probability that is basically the angle between them divided by pi. So it's arc cos rho over pi. That's the probability that that it's cut. So for this graph, it's exactly, this is the true max cut value is exactly this. And so the true max cut value is exactly this. Now, if you sample, basically, if you take a lot of random points here, with very high probability, the finite graph you get will also have like this max cut. And so basically, the hard thing to prove, like this is not hard to calculate, the hard thing to prove is how do you know, and this is what like why this isoperimetric thing is not a trivial theorem, how do you know that there isn't some very crazy, you know, partition that somehow does better than just taking a hyperlink cut? How do you kind of make sure that no matter what crazy partition you do, it's not better than a hyperplane? And this is actually like something that's kind of underlies many integrality gaps. Let's see how well this works. So this is actually something that repeats itself in many integrality gaps, and it's something that actually repeats itself in many parts of theoretical computer science. So this is a form of this isoperimetric inequality. The classical isoperimetric inequality says, you know, you take the circle is the shape in, say, in the plane that minimizes the ratio between the boundary and the volume. So any other shape, which is kind of intuitively true, but also not at all clear how you would do it. So if you take any other shape that has the same the same boundary, then it will have a smaller amount of volume. Which kind of makes sense. You're trying to, if you move around, then you're getting more boundary for the same volume. So it kind of makes sense, but it's not trivial to prove. And this inequality gap basically is some higher dimension version of a statement like that. Basically says that this hyperplane, so it's again like relating volume with boundary. And this is kind of a general, so I have this, all these musings in the lecture notes, but it really is a very general statement that we keep using again and again, which is this type of theorem. So there is this optimality theorem. Which basically says, if you're optimal in some, its optimality theorems is for a particular type of objective, like say the ratio between boundary and volume. If you're optimal in that, then you must be some kind of a nice set. Then, there is kind of stability theorems. So a stability theorem here will say something like, if you are a shape that has very, very close ratio of your volume to boundary as to the ratio as the circle, then you are actually also close to a circle. So that would be like a stability theorem. That not only is the circle the optimum thing, but everything that's nearly optimum, it's nearly a circle. And then the hardest thing, but also often the most useful thing, is what's known as inverse theorems, which would say in this thing is that if you have some kind of a non-trivial relation between your volume and your boundary, then you must be circle-ish in some form. And I don't know exactly even how to phrase it in here, but basically these are some things, like for example, in the world of coding theory, typically what we think of stability theorem, this is known as unique decoding. So basically it says, if you satisfy some test or something like that, and you almost satisfy it with like 99% success, then you're close to a code word. And this will be is known as least decoding. So if you have something, if you're somewhat better than random, there has to be a reason for that. And this is something that just doesn't arise just in in coding or in isoperimetric questions. For example, you can ask the question of you have a subset. You have a subset of numbers, say that satisfies A plus A equals A, that if, no matter what pair of points you add to it, you always get a point, then it's a subgroup. But then you can ask if A plus A is smaller than some K times A, is it an approximate subgroup? And if K is really small, then this is like a stability theorem. When K becomes larger, this is like an inverse theorem. And we have some sort of theorems like that. And this is a whole area of additive combinatorics. There's also questions of linearity testing and testing for low degree polynomials. And all of these things have this kind of form where you want to say maybe you have some kind of test. Usually it's not that hard to prove that if you satisfy the test perfectly, then you must be something nice, maybe a linear function, maybe a low degree polynomial. But then you want to prove that if you nearly satisfy it perfectly, then you are nearly this thing. And then the hardest thing is typically you want to say, if you beat random, then you must be somewhat correlated in some form with a nice function. And we'll kind of see it in the third hour, we'll kind of see it again. So, so basically, this is what I wanted to say about integrality gaps for degree two, in particular the Feige-Shechtman graph. So, any questions at this point? Yes.
So So the example that we've actually gone over is some infinite graph, and mm-hmm. you get finite graphs by like sampling some sufficiently large mm-hmm. set of vertices from there. Mm-hmm. So this is sort of like using the probabilistic method.
Mm-hmm.
Do we think it's possible to do this sort of argument with some deterministic construction?
Probably, yeah. I think in some sense, in this case, if you were to take somehow fine enough mesh of, because there is really no limit in some sense to, there is no relation to how many points you want to take. Basically the dimension, we didn't even talk about the dimension of this field. The dimension is related to what accuracy you want. What accuracy you want to achieve to this bound. But once you decide on the dimension, now you can take a really large number of points. So you can basically decide that you're going to take, you know, all points, all points which, so you take all x, all v, somehow that in Rn, where of norm 1, where vi is some integer times delta for some really tiny delta.
Okay, so you don't need to actually sample.
Yeah, you don't need to actually sample
a deterministic approximation of the sphere. Okay.
Right, so you don't need, so you don't really need a probabilistic method for this. But this is maybe related to the next thing, which is, what if d is larger than 2? So these are integrality gap for degree 2 sum of squares, but we know that they are not integrality gaps for a larger degree sum of squares. So for the odd cycle, it's an exercise, and actually it turns out this exercise actually succeeds in the Feige-Shechtman graph. So it turns out that if you look at this graph, so this graph on the sphere, suppose you kind of intersect this sphere with a plane, much more like what I'm doing when I'm drawing it at the on the blackboard, then you will have this kind of, so I think the easiest way to think about it is when rho is like one minus, when you connect the two guys, if their dot product is like u dot v is like minus 1 plus epsilon. So you can take u1 and then v1 will be here, and then you can go back here, maybe to, so this, let's say this is U1, this is U2, this will be U3, and the distance here, the angle U, will be roughly square root epsilon. And so you can go like back and forth here, and after about square root epsilon steps, you basically could reach here without having to go back. Which basically what I want to say is that there is an odd cycle in this graph of about all of 1 over square root epsilon edges. And moreover, these odd cycles kind of cover nicely the graph. Like basically you can almost partition the edges of the graph into a disjoint or nearly disjoint collection of odd cycles. And each one of them, so you can kind of certify that the max cut value is at most 1 minus square root epsilon using these odd cycles, which also in particular implies that, say, degree 6 sum of squares certifies for this graph that the number of odd cycles is at most, the max cut is at most 1 minus some constant times square root epsilon. And we had a paper, me with David Stor, Moritz Hart, and Thomas Hollenstein, where we kind of showed that even if you subsample randomly a much smaller number of vertices, so that so small in fact that there are no more odd cycles, no more short cycles in the graph has large curve, it's still the case that sum of squares of degree 6 still can certify it. And somewhat strangely, we still use the fact of the odd cycles, some of the like phantom cycles that even though they don't exist, some squares can still use them. Maybe sometimes there is an advantage when you believe in unicorns. So we kind of know that these guys will not, that these kind of things will not work for a larger degree. And basically now we're going to take a break, and after the break I'll talk about what does work for a larger degree. Okay, so let's take. So anyway, I guess, I don't know if it's been comfortable, but if you have kind of feedback on, you know, if you feel that I'm too much repeating what's already in the notes, or the other way around, that I'm not going in enough detail, and even though it's in the notes, you would still kind of prefer that I show the proof line by line, you can tell me in person, you can email me, you can write to me anonymously if you prefer, although there is really no shame in either of you. Just let me know if you feel like I'm going too fast or too slow, or there is anything else you'd prefer me to, you know, to talk about, the high level, the low level details, or And please do ask questions, and including questions that kind of throw us on a tangent, because again, like you have the notes, the proofs are there, so I want to try to use this time for discussions and kind of high level things. So now, okay, so we want to go to degree larger than 2, so we want to prove we want to prove theorems for degree higher than 2, and there is one thing that computer scientists can help from can learn from mathematics, and this is the following. So, you know, given our kind of referring culture, this is not completely mandatory. But it turns out it really helps if the theorem you're trying to prove is true. Like, we computer scientists can prove it even otherwise, but it's easier if it's actually true. It's that's like easier. So why don't we try to prove two theorems when we're trying to to show the low bounds for sum of squares? And how do we know it's true? So, you know, every kid, you know. Even my kid, even though he doesn't know how to count till 5, knows that there is no sub-exponential time algorithm for SAT, right? So this is right? So this is a dogma. And now this means, basically by the PCP theorem, and by the theorem of Hastad, and some fancy PCPs of Moshkowitz and Vaz, basically this means the following, that there is no 2 to the n to the 0.99 algorithm that can distinguish between the two, the following things, the yes case given a 3XO instance, so 3XO instance is variables, is equations on n Boolean variables that are of the form xi, xo, xj, xo, xk equals aijk. So so it cannot distinguish between the case, the yes case, the value is at least 0.99, and the no case, the value is at most 0.51. So the value is the maximum fraction of equations you can satisfy, and basically Hastad proved that if SAT is hard, then there is a reduction showing that 3XO, even approximating it, is hard in this way. So in particular, if there, if there is no n to the 0.99 algorithm, so we can make the following prediction. That there exists degree D, which is n to the 0.99 the pseudo distribution, such that mu and there is an instance such that the expectation according to mu is at least 0.99, but the truth is that the value is at most 0.51. Why is that the case? Because if the if this wasn't the case, if for every instance where the true value was at most 0.51, the best pseudo distribution was at most 0.98, then we could use that to distinguish between these two cases. Because if the true value is at least 0.99, there is definitely a pseudo distribution given this value. And if it was the case that for every instance where the true value is at most 0.51, the best pseudo distribution is at most 0.98, then we could have distinguished between the yes and the no case. So basically, if we believe that there is no sub-exponential time algorithm for SAT, then that implies that we have this, there should exist this integrality gap. And it's always kind of nice that when we have these kind of predictions to try to actually prove them unconditionally. It might also give us some, at least some warm feeling that maybe the beliefs we are basing these predictions on are actually true. So, and this is what Grigoriev did. So the theorem, that Grigoriev proved was the following. He basically proved this prediction, but then he did it even better. So instead of n to the 0.99, he actually got omega of n, even nicer. And we probably could have predicted that maybe even this problem should be actually exponentially hard, so maybe that's not so surprising. The thing that's maybe even more surprising and somewhat even too good is that he actually showed that the value equals 1, that you can give a pseudo distribution that pretends that you can completely satisfy it. And this is somewhat annoying because we think of sum of squares as this strong algorithm, but we can, this problem is not hard to distinguish between the case that you can satisfy completely a set of linear equations and the case that you can't. Because apparently solving linear equations is known how to do in polynomial time, even modulo 2. Okay? So there is this algorithm called Gaussian elimination. It apparently does it. So so one excuse for sum of squares pitiful performance here is to say that you know, sum of squares doesn't really know how to take advantage of the difference between 1 and 0.99. And because of the 0.99 thing is hard, then sum of squares just you know, gives up even when it's 1. But maybe the reason is that I kind of like to make excuses for sum of squares and other people would be more critical of it. Okay, so, and here we actually are going to use this probabilistic method, and we're going to use, the idea is going to use a random free XOR instance. So let's just kind of get like some sense of what is a random 3XOR instance. So basically, random 3XOR instance, we select random equations. So we select n equations of the form xi, xo, xj, xo, xk equals aijk. So we select m equations like that. So let's just kind of get like some intuition. Suppose that m is like n over 2, so we select n over 2 equations in n variables. What do you think will be the value of this system? What how many equations would you be able to satisfy? What? All of them. Yes. The two, it's all of them. They are very highly likely to be linearly independent. If you have n, you know, less than n, you have linearly independent equations, you can find, you can solve for them and find a solution. On the other hand, when m is like, you know, 2n, then they are very likely, I mean, they cannot be linearly independent, very likely to be linearly dependent, but also very unlikely to have. It's very likely that any assignment will kind of fail to satisfy some chunk of them. And generally, if m is like you know O of n over epsilon squared, then you don't expect to satisfy more than a half plus epsilon fraction of them. And one way to see that is that the number of equations you satisfy is a random variable with a mean m over 2 and a standard deviation. Standard deviation is like O of square root m. So the best assignment, there are 2 to the n possible assignments, you kind of expect the best assignment to have roughly square root mn. You kind of expect the best assignment to have like square root n standard deviation above the mean, because that would be like probability 2 to the minus n. So if there are 2 to the n assignments, you kind of, that what you roughly would expect. So this, if m is like n over epsilon, if m is like n over epsilon squared, this would be like m over 2 plus O of epsilon m. Okay, so that's kind of like the rough intuition why that is what you would expect, and the actual calculations, that's in the lecture notes. Okay, so if you take a random instance, it's very unlikely that you could satisfy more than say 51% of, no matter how you assign the variable, it's very unlikely that you can satisfy more than 51%. And the kind of surprising thing is that you can actually do it, that there is a pseudo distribution that actually pretends to satisfy all of them. And so let's So basically, the way we kind of represent a random CSP is we think of it as a bipartite graph, where there are m clauses, so m constraints, m equations, and n variables. So each constraint is connected to three variables, right? I, j, k, and in addition, I will have this vector a1 till am. And so we think of an instance as g, comma a. And then basically the proof boils down to two lemmas. So now we want to prove that there exists. So we've proven that if we choose g and a at random, and in fact what turns out that we only need to choose a at random, doesn't matter what g we choose, with very high probability we're not going to be able to satisfy 51% of the equations. Now we want to prove that there exists a pseudo distribution, and the lemma boils down to two properties. So we want to say is that we're going to set the degree d that we work with to some delta n. Delta will be some small enough constant. Let's ignore what it is. So lemma one says the following: with high probability, G is a great expander. Which means that for every subset T of the left side of the constraints, if the subset T has at most, say, 100 vertices, then the neighbors of T is going to be at least 1.7 the size of T. So how many edges, if you have a set of size, if you have some set T of size K on this side, how many edges are going out of it?
Three K,
right? Three the size of T, yes. And basically what it says is that, so a priori you could have hoped maybe for three times T, and you get at least 1.7. What turns out to be important is this 1.7 is better than 1.5. You get more than half of the neighbors you could hope for, and it turns out you couldn't expect something better than 2. That's an exercise that's written there. So this is lemma 1, and this is kind of a lemma, this is just a lemma about random graphs. You can prove that, the proof is there in the notes, and you basically, you do a union bound over all possible subsets and you do the calculation and it comes out. So, just believe me about this lemma. Or, you should have read the proof so you know it. Okay, so, the heart of the matter here is this lemma 2. Which also may be somewhat troubling if someone says that somewhat stupid in some sense, because what it says is that if G is an expander in that sense, a great expander in that sense, then doesn't matter what's on the right hand side. It doesn't matter what's on the right hand side, some squares will always think that you can satisfy all the equations. So there exist some degree d mu such that for every maybe one way to so for every l in m expectation of mu of this call it this some polynomial of degree 3 or so that checks that xi, xo, xj, xo, xk equals al is 1, where I, j, k are the neighbors of L. Okay, So part of the reason I'm writing this lemma just to make sure that we are all in the same page on notation. So I hope we are. So right. So this lemma says that there is a pseudo distribution that satisfies all has the in expectation. It satisfies all the constraints. Like every constraint is satisfied. Is that clear? Okay. So basically there are two parts when you want to prove this. There are two parts when you want to prove this kind of lemma. And part one is you want to construct the pseudo distribution mu, and part two is you want to prove that the pseudo distribution mu is positive semi-definite. And by now we kind of have Grigoriev had to, you know, be smart, or he has used some intuition to come up with these pseudo distributions. By now we kind of have some rules how we come up with these distributions, and we kind of view it through this Bayesian point of view. So we say, you know, how do we come up with mu? So we want to say, okay, it's a random, so our prior is that mu is simply, you know, the uniform distribution over 0, 1 to the n. Right, a priori, if we didn't know anything, we didn't look at the formula at all, it's a random formula, random, what can we say about about the solution, would be random. Right, but then we see something, we say, okay, we observe that x7, x015, x32 needs to be 1. So we say, okay, you know, we observe that, there is no, you know, we have to set this, we have to respect that. So then we say, okay, it's almost uniform, but let's modify this. Let's set the expectation of 1 minus 2x7, 1 minus 2x15, 1 minus 2x32 to be minus 1. This is kind of 1 minus 2x7, it's like a convenient linear transformation that makes 0 into plus 1 and 1 into minus 1, then XO becomes multiplication. Okay, so we have to do that. Then we observe maybe that x32, and we see that there is also this equation, let's say x32, XO x49, XO x72 equals 0. So we do the same thing, right? We say, okay, we're going to set the pseudo expectation of these guys plus 1. But then we actually observe, we can actually learn something if we have these two equations. What can we learn? We can add them, right? Exactly. So we can add them and find out that x7, xo, x15, xo, x49, xo, x72 equals 1, which basically corresponds here in this world to multiplying these two equations. So we get this expectation of 1 minus 2x7, blah blah blah, until 1 minus 2x72 equals minus 1. So the idea is we say, okay, we start with uniform distribution, but now we modify moments as we need to do it. But we have to be a little bit careful, because what would happen if we were to combine all linear relations that we know of, or that exist in this system of equations? So one thing is that basically we would be able to show that 1 equals 0, right? Because this is an inconsistent system of linear equations. It's not satisfiable, not even close. So we somehow have to be careful in what we do, and the idea is that we only deal with the equations that are at most of degree D. So we do all these things up to degree D, but if two things of degree D, we add them together, it becomes degree 2D, we say, okay, we don't write this down, we don't make use of this information, we are D-bounded. And so
wouldn't that simplify things greatly if we if we just did a change of variables, so define like yk equals 1 minus 2xk, and then all these are binomials?
We are going to do it, but it wouldn't simplify things super greatly, but yeah.
Just notation.
Yes, but basically we are going to do it. So basically the way we are going to do is we are going to span our polynomials. We define this function chi s is the product of I and s of 1 minus 2xi, and we are going to write the expectation for these functions, which are the monomials in the yi's, and the law is the following. We are going to say, okay, if you have I xo j xo k equals a, then you define chi of the expectation of chi I j k to be 1 minus 2a, and the number law is that if s and t have been defined, if s and t satisfy that the symmetric difference of s and t is at most d, and they themselves are at most d, we can define the excitation of the symmetric difference to be, assuming these guys were defined before, to be the product of these. And for anything that wasn't defined, we keep it at zero, because that's in the uniform distribution, all the chi s will have expectation zero. And we're trying to stick to the uniform distribution as much as we can, except for the things where we are forced not to do it. And now basically, this is the process, and now you basically have to do two things. You have to prove that if, first of all, that this makes sense in the sense that you're not going to define two things in a different way. And second thing is that if it does make sense, then it is going to be Then it is going to be PSV, and it turns out that the second thing is actually pretty easy. So not bad. Okay, yes, you can leave that. If I learn how to do the work with this board, I'll ask all the lectures to be here, because I don't want to have this skill set go to waste. So we basically have to prove two claims, right? So claim one is that we don't blow up. By blowing up, I mean that we don't apply this rule, and suddenly we see that we have to assign to, we are trying to assign to the expectation of chi s symmetric difference with t plus 1, where we've already assigned to it minus 1 before. So that would be kind of unpleasant. So claim 1 is don't blow up, and claim 2 is that the resulting thing is a valid pseudo-distribution, which is going to be clearly like a linear operator, etc. So the thing that you need to prove is that it's going to be the thing that you need to prove is that it's going to be satisfy the expectation of a square is non-negative, and that thing actually follows pretty easily. the proof of claim 2 is basically you write a polynomial p as a sum of some coefficient alpha s chi s, and then you write what is the pseudo expectation of p squared. It's going to be by linearity, it's going to be sum over s and t expectation of pseudo alpha s alpha t pseudo expectation of chi s chi t, and now the point is that basically for everything that we have defined, we can always change this into expectation of chi s expectation of chi t, because that will always hold for the way we define things. So if this was non-zero and this was non-zero, then this will be the product of them, and if this is zero, and similarly, if this is zero, this must be also zero, because otherwise this will be non-zero, this will be non-zero, then this has to be the product of those guys. So so it's always going to be so it's always going to satisfy this equation, and once you do that, then it's basically it is a square, right? It's just sum over s alpha s to the expectation of chi s, all that squared. So so it's sum quantity squared, which is always negative. Yes.
So like chi s for s now defined by that process, is that assumed just zero?
Yes, okay. Yes, because that we want to stay with the uniform distribution. So actually what will happen is that the vast majority of things will not be defined.
Yeah.
So and they will be simply zero. But if two things are non-zero, then the expectation of the product is the product of the expectations. Okay, so but now we just have to prove that we don't blow up, and let me kind of give you just the intuition of why we don't blow up. And the idea is the following: if we look at this graph, and basically if you got a contradiction, it means you added up equations and you got that one equals zero, so it must be some linear dependency. So it means you somehow got a set here of equations, let's call this set T, that is a linear dependency. Now, let's just look at the first time this set. So the claim is that we can assume without loss of generality that the set T is at most, I don't know, 20 times D, where D is the degree. And the reason is that the way we do these derivations, we only deal with sets of size d. So the first time we get a dependency, it will be we can assume that it has at most 10 d. Yes.
Okay. But now I'm going back to claim 2, unfortunately.
Right.
Okay. I just realized I'm confused about something, which is, what happens if chi s and chi t, we individually don't know the value of either of them, but we do know the value of their product from the given information?
Okay.
So in that case, the pseudo expectation of chi s and chi t are both zero, right?
Okay. So if you
know.
Okay, so let's see. So chi s is kind of going to be zero, chi t is going to be zero, and
chi t would be non zero.
S x o t, s t. So we know that this thing is not zero. That's a good question.
First of all, is that possible? It seems like it's possible. But.
Okay, so let's see. Let's see. So if S. So if we know S, X, O, T.
Yeah, it's possible because you can just bring any S as. And then you can delta that was found with.
Yeah. Wait, so if okay, S is 0.
It's okay.
T 0, S XOR T. Let's see what we know here. No, I have to.
It's a valid distribution.
What?
Every time when chi s is minus 1, chi t is minus 1. Every time when chi s is 1, chi t is 1. Then the expectation of chi s o plus t is always 1.
So
I mean this is okay too.
No, then okay, but we need the spoof. Right, so in this spoof I kind of assume that I could write this as chi s chi t, and this, in this case I cannot do that. And now I have to remember.
So first of all, the union thing cannot happen. Say, for example, S and T are disjoint, then that cannot happen. It's clear, right?
No, I guess now what I'm seeing is like, suppose you have like the equation x1, xo, x2, xo, x3 equals 1, then what about chi1 versus chi2, 3? Then both of those are 0, but the expectation of them is non-zero, and now I have to remember there was an issue here which now I think I kind of put under the rug, and now I have to remember. I think yes.
I see.
I think this proof is a little bit.
Maybe you explicitly split into equivalence classes.
Yes. I think I had to do something a little bit more. This proof is slightly more subtler than this. Basically, I think what you do is the following: you say that S is equivalent to T.
If the expectation of S delta X, S delta T is defined.
Yeah, if the expectation of X, X delta T is not zero, and what you do, what you show.
But if two things are equivalent, they always have the same.
Right, so if two things. Okay, so you can show that this is an equivalence relation, and now what you do is you basically can show that. Okay, so now what you do is you write P as P1 plus. PC, where you group together the coefficients that are in the same equivalence relation. So if two things are not equivalent, then expectation of PI, PJ will always be zero. So these guys, so then it reduces to the case where
So now we just get a sum over all the equivalence classes.
Right. So now you just need to prove. Now you can assume that S is in the same is in some equivalence class. Now you can kind of shift by the equivalence class, take it out. So you can basically, regardless of generality, assume that expectation of chi S is non-zero for every coefficient. And then this equation holds.
What?
Sorry,
I don't know what's happening.
Yes.
Is it saying that this matrix, I mean that this equalizing form is rank 1? I mean, module.
No, so I think this equivalence class is the thing that makes sure that.
I mean, module idea, right? But the claim is that that's actually rank 1.
So it's not really. Right, so basically, what will happen is if you actually looked at this guy, it will be like a bunch of rank 1 blocks. The quadratic form corresponding to this pseudo expectation will be a bunch of rank one blocks corresponding to these equivalence classes. So when you write a polynomial, so P1 will be the part here, P2 will be the part here, Pk will be the part here, and so this will be a PhD rank one, this will be a PhD rank one, etc. And the dot product of if you look at the sum of pi with the quadratic form, then you'll get sum of the pi squared. Is this clear or is not so clear?
I guess I'm just confused, but
okay, so let's maybe, okay, maybe why don't we, I mean, since I cannot really tell you that this proof is in the nodes because the proof in the nodes is wrong. So why don't I actually prove it?
Okay.
So the idea is the following. We define S to be equivalent to T if expectation of chi S chi T is not zero.
And just to be clear, we're assuming S and T each have degree less than
at most
two. At most D over two, right?
At most D over two, yes. At most D over two.
I think if we're at most D when the definition is
At most D over two, yes. So S and T, if at most D over two, we say that they are equivalent if expectation of the pseudo expectation of chi S chi T is not zero. Now I leave it as an exercise to verify that this is an equivalence relation. It's reflexive, transitive, and the other thing. So it is an equivalence relation. That's not hard to show. So now now we basically write. So we have this polynomial P of degree at most d over two, and we write. So we write P as, you know, let's write it alpha 1 chi s. When we write it in the chi basis plus alpha some, I don't know, t chi s t. And we bunch together these guys to equivalence class. So we call this one p1, this is p2, and this is pc. So we bunch together all the coefficients that correspond to the same equivalence class. Now, if you take, now we look at expectation, the pseudo expectation of P squared, which is the pseudo expectation of, you know, sum alpha I chi S I squared. Now we open this all up, so we can all open it also up, this all up. But what we see is that if we have two things that are not equivalent to each other, then the expectation of the product is zero, so they vanish. So what will really happen is that it's going to be the sum of the pseudo expectation of pi squared. So we just have to prove that each one of those is individually non-negative. Okay. So now for a guy that's where everyone is in the same equivalence class. Okay. So we go back to this in a second. So now we can assume that P P is of the form sum alpha I chi S I, where chi S I, so all of them are there exists some representative, let's call it S zero, such that S zero the expectation of chi S0 chi Si is 0 for every I. Okay? So, now what we do is we. What we do is we are going to shift by S0. So we know that this is, so we know that chi, so what we do is the following, we're going to write this as P, we're going to write it as sum alpha I, so we write the expectation of chi S0, chi S0, Si, and now we're going to look at the squared, right, so expectation of P squared, it's going to, so now we get alpha I, alpha J, this chi S0, I guess you dot S I chi S zero chi S zero symmetric difference with S J, and now we want to claim that and this thing has to be the product of these two other things, and now I have to remember why we say that. So we know that chi s zero, chi s I is not zero, and chi s zero, chi s j is not zero, so the product has to be the product of the expectations. So so we get that the expectation of the expectation of chi si chi sj is the expectation of chi s0 chi si times the expectation of chi s0 chi sj. Okay? So now basically what happens is that we can argue that the expectation of p squared is equal to sum alpha I to the expectation of chi s0 chi si all that squared, which is non-negative. Right, this is a sum number, that's what we care about, so this is sum number. And what we used here is simply that this thing, right? That chi s I s j is equal to chi, expectation of chi, this is chi, chi s zero s I times the expectation of chi s zero s j. And the point is that this is non-zero, so this has to be the product of the two. Okay, so this now okay? Okay. Okay. So we are basically had to reduce to avoid the case that Michael talked about. We had to kind of restrict ourselves to the same equivalence class. And now let me say something about why. Okay, so this is the claim proof of. Claim one that we didn't blow up. And now let me say something, maybe I'll say it here, why this implies that we don't get into a contradiction. And the idea is the following. A contradiction really corresponds to, first of all, we must get to a linear dependency. So linear dependency is a set of equations that are dependent. In particular, if we have this set of equations, then they are dependent, it means that every, if you look at the variables that that this set of equations touches, then every variable has to be cancelled, so it has to be touched at least twice. Right, so this ring has degree 3 on the left, and if you look at the neighbors, every one of these neighbors gets touched at least twice. So that means that the size of this neighbor set is at most 1.5 times the size of T, because there are three T edges going out, but we are wasting half of them because every guy has to get hit at least twice. So that doesn't automatically means that there exists no linear dependency in this graph. In fact, there exists a linear dependency in this graph. There are more equations than variables. There is definitely a linear dependency in the graph. And but what we can show is that that basically if you go along the derivation, because every time when we do this derivation we work with sets that the variable sets, the corresponding variable is the size at most d, we can show that we can find like the first time that some of this set becomes large, it's still not super large, so t we'll be able to show that there is somewhere along the line the set of T has size at most say 10D or 20D. And then that's a contradiction, because small sets, in this graph there are large linear dependencies, but there are no small linear dependencies. And in the actual proof, you can see in the note, that proof is actually, I think, correct, at least. At least let's not show it so we don't have, so then it's safe. Yes.
Sometimes, or one can argue about semi-identity relaxation versus LP relaxation.
Yes.
So the difference is you look at subspaces rather than coordinate subspaces.
Yes.
But this argument somehow is based on sets that are going to be somehow coordinate sets of variables, right? I mean, those are somehow coordinate aligned
yes.
subspaces.
Yes.
So somehow, why somehow this added power of semi-identity stuff would not show up in here?
Right, so this is a good question. So somehow, I think what happens, I mean, this is indeed like for 3XO and also 3SAT, it is the case that semi-definite programming is not more powerful than linear programming. So basically, if you wanted to come up with the same, with a pseudo-distribution for linear programming, so basically, we didn't talk about what's the definition of pseudo distribution for linear programming, but one way to say it is you drop this condition. You don't have this condition that this has to be non-negative. But rather, what they do in linear program, they say that if you have some f that only depends on k variables, and it's non-negative, then that only depends on k variables and it's non-negative, then you want that expectation of capital F is always non-negative. A capital F is applying small f on some k of its input variables. So that's somehow like some, so basically in some sense that's like Pablo says, it's like picking a basis. You're saying, it's not all of the degree polynomials, but we somehow treat the coordinate basis as special, and we only look at polynomials that the reason they are low degree is because they only touch k variables. And it is true that for somehow for 3XO, it doesn't seem like the power of changing basis doesn't seem to be useful, maybe because in some sense this problem is so hard that we don't really know how to do anything to it. So while for the max cut problem, like linear programming is super pitiful and cannot even distinguish, you know, you can go to exponential time and you can still cannot distinguish between basically a bipartite graph and a random bipartite graph and a random graph. For 3XO, the problem is so hard. I mean, it's maybe for 3XO, linear programming is still pitiful, but also semi-definite programming is pitiful. In some sense, every algorithm we know is pitiful. We just don't, I mean, this problem is so hard that basically we don't know how to do. So one way to think about it is that the pseudo-distribution kind of encodes the most naive thing that anyone looking at this problem would know, right? So they said, okay, I don't know anything except I know that, you know, the equations are true, and if I add up a small bunch of them, then it also should be true. And basically, for this problem, it's so hard that SDP doesn't do better. I don't know if it answers to some extent. Yeah, so the nice thing about this is that, this thing generalizes, and we'll see also later how we generalize this to other CSPs. And there is this very, very simple observation, but somehow very useful. Basically says, so basically basically what it says is that if you say mu is a degree d pseudo distribution and p is a degree k polynomial, then if you define a mu, I never know how to write mu, I think it's this thing, I'm not sure. So if we define mu to be like the distribution where we basically look at p of x where x comes from mu, then this is degree at least d over k pseudo distribution. So basically, if you, so this is very easy to prove. But basically what it says is that if you do some small manipulation or like low degree manipulations to a pseudo distribution, it's still a pseudo distribution. And the reason that it's very useful is the following thing. So typically the way, first of all, this proof will basically show that say three sat is also hard. And typically the way you want to show now that a different problem is hard, the general idea is usually you will have a reduction. So you get a reduction that takes some instance of say three sat and converts it to some instance I prime. And the reduction will usually say if there is a good solution for three sat, then there is a good solution for I prime, and if there isn't one for if there isn't a good solution, there also isn't one here. But it's typically constructive, so and we'll go back to this point in a few minutes after the break. But basically, typically constructive, that means that we have an efficient way to take an assignment for the three sat and convert it into some P of X, which is kind of an assignment for this I prime. And typically, it's actually these things that's kind of like local perturbation, so it's typically will be a low degree polynomial. Basically, these manipulations will be like a low degree polynomial. Every coordinate will be a low degree polynomial, which means that if we had a pseudo distribution for the sat instance, we also have a pseudo distribution for the resulting problem. So it basically means that if we had a reduction showing that if sat is hard and some problem bla is hard, then we can start with this instance of hard instance and get that bla is hard unconditionally for sum of squares. So in the notes there is a particular form that's really useful to start from, which is basically the sum of squares analog of the PCP theorem, and typically that allows us to take many hardness results, computational hardness results, that under assumptions work for any algorithm and convert them into unconditional results that for the sum of squares algorithm. So basically, if you know how to prove that something is NP hard, you also know how to prove unconditionally that sum of squares cannot do it, which is what you would expect, but it's still nice to prove these kind of things unconditionally. So, questions? Okay, so let's take another 8 minute break. 7 or 8. So in the last, which I'll definitely end off on time because we all have to get to the break. So this last result, which I'm going to talk about at a very high level, I kind of find it ultra cool. And this is even as someone that doesn't believe the assumption in the statement of the theorem, I still find the result ultra cool. So that basically what we saw in the last lecture, we take something that's NP hard and we get an integrality gap. And that's kind of to be expected. If we believe something is hard for every possible algorithm, it should also be hard for this algorithm. But the result we are talking about now is the other thing. We take an integrality gap and convert it into a hardness result.
Okay, good.
And this is just, to me it's like, what the fuck, man? It's like, how can you do that? If you think about it, integrality gap is basically just saying, that some graph, some finite object of like 100 vertices or 1,000 vertices has, one combinatorial quantity different than some other quantity, right? Some, the maximum, the maximum cut is different than the maximum pseudo distribution, which is some kind of maximum eigenvalue of some matrix or whatever. So it's kind of pretty cool that you take this. Why would the existence of this one particular finite object be an obstruction to every possible polynomial time algorithm? I mean, especially if you think about, well, the algorithm can know about this object. It's only constant. You can hardwire the algorithm to know about this object. How could this object stop the algorithm from working? And but this is the beauty of this thing. And the idea is that basically the integrality gap becomes this gadget that allows to do the reduction. And we'll show it. So generally, this is so this basically is kind of a theorem that says, you know, if some squares can't do it, no algorithm can do it. So that's pretty cool. And ideally, like what you would want is kind of this is like a dream theorem. And kind of want to say that for some large family of problems, say, so large family, script F of problems, let's say maximization problems like maxcut, what you have is that if you take the best efficient algorithm, so you take the minimum efficient algorithm A, and you take the worst problem for that, like say the maximum instance. Basically, want to say that for like some sub-large family, it holds that for every problem pi in the family, the maximum, the instance that maximizes, say, the difference between what A thinks the value is and the true value, is roughly the same as the worst case for the sum of squares algorithm. For you take the worst instance for sum of squares, the sum of squares value for value d minus the true value. Right, so this basically, this is a kind of dream theorem that will tell you that for this large family of problems, the SOS computes value that might not be the right value, but it's the best that you could do if you're restricted to an efficient algorithm. And of course, to do that, you need to assume that, say, P is different from NP. And Raghavendra almost proved this thing. So basically what he proved, Raghavendra 08, he proved that if P is different from NP, and he needed to use this UGC, which is a huge caveat in some sense because we don't know if it's true. I think it's false, but some other people think it's true, so you can say that there is no consensus. And what he proved is basically this thing is true, and in fact he proved it for SOS of degree 2, which basically also a corollary for problems in this family. And SOS 2 is the same as SOS with degree 100, or SOS with degree some n to the little of 1. So this is a pretty cool theorem, regardless of what you think of this Unigames conjecture, and let's just try to define the theorem and say something about the proof.
So this really specifically says that if you can beat the SOS values, then you can solve Unigames problems, right?
Yes. Yeah, if you find an efficient algorithm that gives you, notice this min-max, so basically if you find an efficient algorithm that gives you a better worst case approximation, say, value than what SOS gives you, really degree 2 SOS, then you have refuted the Unigames conjecture. But just the idea that you could take, imagine that there is a hope of proving such a result can suggest maybe we could prove this result for, based on NP hardness, or maybe we could prove the Unigames conjecture and then get this result based on NP hardness. So that's I think pretty impressive, at least to me. I don't know, maybe some people are more I kind of find it pretty impressive. And again, you can, I mean, it's not there are some maybe other results in the literature that you can somehow interpret in this kind of way, but I don't really know of anything that's really has this kind of the same nature. Okay, so the problems that Prasad looked at are constraint satisfaction problems, and basically what the idea is that you have you're thinking of variables that are in some alphabet sigma to the n, and you have some constraints that really only depend on some k variables. So MaxCut is an example like that, and you're trying to satisfy as many constraints as possible. So MaxCut is an example like that. For every edge, you have a constraint that says we want this edge to be cut, and you're trying to cut as many edges as possible, so you're trying to satisfy as many constraints as possible. And basically, what we call a CS gap for some parameter C, which is kind of the completeness, and S is the soundness, a CS gap is basically some instance. You typically think of some family of predicates, so some instance of CSP of this family, such that the true value, right, so the maximum over all X of the value that X gives for this instance is at most S. But on the other hand, there exists a pseudo distribution such that the pseudo expectation of the value is at least C. So this is the gap. This shows that sum of squares will typically think of degree 2 pseudo distributions. Actually, degree 2, you have to, especially if the alphabet is sigma, you kind of have to describe exactly how you phrase it as a degree 2 pseudo distribution, and there is some kind of an extensive footnote on this in the lecture notes about exactly how you phrase it. Doesn't matter for us so much if it was degree 2 or degree 50 at this point, so these kind of issues of formulations are not really important. So this basically says that that there is a gap, and basically there is a gap for the sum of squares algorithm. And basically what Prasad shows is that given this, there is the problem is actually hard, and the way it basically shows is that given this such a gap instance, we can show a reduction from the unique game problem to the CSP problem, where yes instances are translated to guys that have value at least C, and no instances are translated to guys that have value at most S. And let me give kind of a very high-level view of the spoof, and then I'll try to kind of illustrate for MaxCut how exactly it works out. So the idea, in some sense, is the following thing. You take an integrality gap, so we basically showed that the heart of the Feige-Schertmann integrality gap is an isoperimetric inequality for the sphere. What basically you can observe is that this is every integrality gap really has to have this thing. So every integrality gap implies some kind of isoperimetric inequality for the sphere. And it really has even this kind of it really has this kind of value. The value it comes is like is value S, which comes from the soundness. So in the MaxCut case, we said that the best cut in this graph is actually this small value, like this soundness value, which was like 0.87 times 0.85845. Generally, any integrality gap will translate into some kind of in as a parametric inequality on the screen that says that some kind of test cannot be passed with a probability more than S over the sphere. And then, basically what they do is, they now, Prasad, by the way, I should say that Prasad's result is, did not come in a vacuum, and it's built heavily on earlier work by Kott Kindler, Mossel and O'Donnell, and also Mossel, Oleshkevitz and O'Donnell. But, so what these guys do is then they take this isoperimetric inequality over the sphere, which I said is kind of an optimality theorem, and they make it into an inverse theorem for the cube. So basically what you want to say is that you have two kinds of functions. You have functions that are special on the cube, which are very non-spherical in some sense. And these, so these nice functions, so the nice functions have value roughly C. And random functions have value roughly S in this test, which I didn't exactly specify what the test is, but there is going to be some test. And in some sense, what you say is kind of randomish or generic functions in some sense, they cannot distinguish between the sphere and the cube. So because we have this inequality over the sphere, random functions, you give them the cube, they still think they're in the sphere, they cannot do better than S. This is something that's known as the invariance principle. And this is, by the way, again, something that's very common in mathematics. Sometimes I think it's called universality theorems, etc. That you sometimes cannot, under certain conditions, you cannot tell apart if you're given, say, Gaussian random variables or 0-1 random variables. And there are other, probably there are more phenomena like that than I can recall at the moment, and some people can chime in. But this is basically what we say is that this invariant principle says that in functions that are kind of generic, they basically think that the cube is the sphere and they get value S. Functions that are very nice, they get this value C. And the important thing is that you have this inverse theorem that if a function gets a value like S plus epsilon, it must be because it's somewhat related to a nice function. So this is this kind of what I mentioned before as an inverse theorem. You're saying if a function performs better in a test than what would a random function do, then there must be a reason for that. And the only reason someone does anything good in this test is because he copied from one of the nice guys. That's one way to think about this inverse theorem. And basically, once you get this, then you get what's known as this Q-based dictator test. Gadget. And this gadget allows you to do a reduction from the unique gains problem to the problem that you started with. Because the whole test, etc., have to do something, they inherit from this integrality gap its form, which was these kind of constraints that you use there. So this is kind of like the ultra cartoon version, and now let me try it. So I don't know if there are questions at this point.
So isoperimetric inequality is hard for some square.
Actually, no. It's hard for the grid 2 sum squares.
Okay.
It's one of the questions is. So these things basically they start from the grid 2. So the So they start from degree 2 in integrality gap, and they end with unique games hardness. Now maybe, you know, since I was already said how much I love this result and I do love it, maybe I can also like give you a somewhat harsh way to describe it, is, you know, garbage in, garbage out. So you started with a poor integrality gap, you only got unique games hardness. And one of the main question is, can you start with, you know, if you started with a better integrality gap, can you get outside from the NP hardness? And we don't really know. Maybe, I mean, if the unique games conjecture is true, then in some sense, you get garbage in and you get diamonds out. You start with a degree 2 integrality gap, and you get that it's hard for any algorithm, including degree n to the epsilon whatever, or n to the little of one sum of squares. So that would be amazing. And one of the interesting things, which seems to be a barrier to these things, but it's not clear even what's its relation, is that these guys, these type of things, we typically do have low degree sum of squares proof. But the degree is not 2. So it's not completely clear that this completely rules out using these things as gadgets, but somehow it's an interesting phenomena. And one that we don't yet completely understand. So I'm not going to spell out this entire this entire thing, but I want to tell you a little bit some of these the ideas here. Okay, so. But I think it's kind of, it's a pretty cool theorem. It's a pretty cool idea that. Yes.
Specifically between which kind of, I mean, it's always hard as volumes, or
so maybe it will become like a little bit clearer, but I can say, okay, so I can say roughly speaking, is the isoperimetrics really come from the constraint satisfaction thing? And basically what it says is that if you have like an integrality gap, let's stick with the case of say MaxCut. The MaxCut integrality gap will really be it automatically defines you some graph on the sphere. Might not be exactly the same graph we've seen before, but some graph on the sphere for which the best MaxCut value is at most this value S. And typically this value S will be easy also to achieve, but basically this tells you that the best cut in this graph is at most an S, where S, you know, is the gap you started from. And generally, if it's a more complicated test, then it somehow might be so it will say that there is a distribution of basically constraints on this graph that any subset of the sphere doesn't satisfy this better than probability S. So basically, we are not going to. So I don't know how many of you know that like, I've seen like a hardness of approximation results and PCP-based results, etc. So we are not going to. Show all of this, but let's talk about what is actually a reduction. So typically a reduction what we do is we take an instance I, we map it to a phi of I, right? That's a reduction. And we want this property that this property of completeness. And that means that if there is an I that is a yes that if this I is a yes instance, suppose this is a constraint satisfaction problem, this is a constraint satisfaction problem, that say if this thing is has a good assignment, if there is an X such that the value with I of X is at least some C star, then it should transform that there is some, let me call it f, such that the value of with phi of I of f is at least c. Right, so suppose I want to show that the problem, I want to show that this problem is C as hard. So it's hard to distinguish between the case that there is a value that at least C versus the case that every assignment has at most S. So, and I start with the assumption that this problem is C star S star hard. So I want to transform a yes instance into a yes instance. And the soundness is if there is no assignment, then if there is no assignment, then there is no assignment here, there is no assignment here. But let me write it in the contrapositive. So I'll write it as, if there exists f here such that the value of f is larger than s, then there should exist x here that the value of I of x is larger than S star. Right, so this is the notion of a reduction. That means that if it was hard to distinguish between value C star and S star here, it would be hard to distinguish between value C and S here. Agreed? And the definition of a reduction is that this part has to be efficient. Right? Otherwise, it's not, you know, inefficient, it doesn't make me say anything. But almost always, this part is basically, how do you prove something like that? You need to show that for every x, there is an f. And typically, this part is also efficient. So this is someone known as an encoding. And this is typically efficient, or almost always efficient in these reductions. So you take an x, and you efficiently encode it as an f. And this part is also often efficient as well. So this is like the decoding. So you take an f that had like some non-trivial success, and you transform it into an x that had non-trivial success. And basically, the way that this particular reduction is going to work is the following. So this x is going to be, the alphabet is going to be numbers from 1 to L for some L. So it's going to be, so every guy here is like a symbol in this alphabet. And the encoding is very simple. We simply replace every symbol with a block of bits. So we're going to map say xk into some block, you call this fk, right? So we're going to map x in ln into this f1 till fn in 0, 1 to the n, going to be times 2 to the n. And the way we think about every, so this every block here will be of size 2 to the L, and the way we are going to encode it is that we encode the encoding, we take the symbol I, we encode it as the function fi, function from 0, 1 to the L to 0, 1. So this is like a string of length 2 to the L, and where fi of w for every w is simply wi. And these functions are known as dictators. The idea is that this comes from social choice theory. You typically think of every Boolean Boolean function as taking the votes of the, I guess it's very relevant for tonight, taking the votes of L members of the populations and coming up to a decision. And basically, a dictator function ignores everyone in the population except W Trump, so WI, and And then say majority function takes the, you know, the sum and rounds it or something like that. Okay. So this is the encoding. We basically encode the symbol I as the ith dictator function. Often it's actually useful to start with this thing. Think, okay, this is encoding, now we need to satisfy these properties. So we're going to need to put some tests. And the idea is the following. The idea, like, let's suppose we are now focused on maxcat. So our goal is to show hardness for maxcat. Then we want to put some graphs. We want to put one large graph on top of it, which we can think of it as a collection of many small graphs. And we want to ensure that if you have a cat that is significantly better than S, then two things happen. First of all, every one of those guys, or most of those guys at least, is somewhat related to a code word in some technical sense. And these code words correspond to something that satisfies the original constraints, which I didn't talk about. And it turns out that really the beauty of unique games, starting from unique games, is that you can kind of forget about trying to satisfy the original constraints. It somehow will happen automatically. And what you need is really some test. So what you really need is... So what you really need is some test that... So you want some graph G with on 0, 1 to the L. So on these vertices, such that F is a dictator, then the cat value of F is basically C. And if the cat value of F is at least the soundness plus epsilon, then F is some sense epsilon related. This sense is a little bit technical. The notion is known as maximum influence, but let's ignore that. Sense epsilon related to a dictator, or some epsilon prime that has to do something with epsilon. So it turns out that if you have this, then the reduction works. And at least you can understand how the reduction will work in the sense of how you're going to do the decoding. So the idea would be that now you know that there is a dictator that is somewhat related to you, you can decode back to a dictator. You have to prove a lot of stuff, but at least you can get off the ground, you know how the decoding will work, and that's the heart of what's going on there. So basically, how are we going to do that? So the idea is the following. So let me, I told you that every integrality graph gives you an isoperimetric inequality, but let me focus on the, say, Fede-Shechmann integrality graph and show you how we can make it into a gadget. Fede-Shechmann integrality graph, recall it was this graph on the sphere. We connected two guys, U and V, if the dot product was roughly rho. Okay? So, how do we make this into a gadget? And the idea is somewhat simpler. So let me say it. So now we want a gadget. So we are going to do the following thing. We are going to here is our gadget G. The graph G is going to be the following. So I'm going to describe it by describing the distribution over edges. So describing how do I choose an edge if I chose an edge at random. So a random edge in G, so x, y in G, so the vertex set is like 0, 1 to the L. You basically choose x at random in L, and yi equals xi with probability. Typically I want it to be. We want 1 minus xi with probability the cut value, which was xgw, which I think was 1 minus ogw over 2 or something like that, or half. Half minus ogw over 2, I think, and xi with probability 1 minus xgw. So yi is so we get this this property, this defines the graph. So one way to define the graph is how do you say the set of edges, and I just talk about the set of edges as the probability. Okay, you can say okay, maybe there are weighted edges. Turns out it doesn't really matter. You can kind of duplicate things. You can make it edges without weight. At this hour of night, let's not, I've been cheating you so much that at this point, like cheating you with adding weights to the edges is like. So this is the graph. Basically, you just take this sphere and you make it into a cube, where like basically the edges will correspond to the edges in substance correspond to the same correlations as you have in the cube, and what is very easy to show is that if f of x is simply xi, then the value of the cut, the probability that f of x, if we take a random edge that f of x is different from f of y, is what we set it out to be. On every coordinate I, it's completely independent. So this probability is going to be exactly xgw. So this is this, which is our completeness gap. So the nice function, the dictators, will give us the value that we wanted. So now the question is, why do we have soundness? So let's think of what is like a very not nice function. So if you are a dictator, then the thing that's most not nice for you is democracy, right? So what is very not nice function? So here is a not nice function f, which is 1 if sum of xi is larger than n over 2, and 0 otherwise. Right? This is the least correlated function with a dictator. Okay? So let's understand what happens. What cut value does this give? So if you look at the probability that f of x is different from f of y, then you, what are we doing? We're looking at the probability. We're basically going to f only really doesn't depend on x and y. It depends. It's really we're looking at the probability of like sum of xi versus sum of yi. This f of and now if you look at sum of xi's, I know it's very late, but if you sum up random independent 0, 1 variables, what do you get? Gaussian, right? So basically what you see is that you basically ask yourself what is, if you take two row correlated variables, so basically x and y may as well be row correlated Gaussians. And if they are row-correlated Gaussians, you can ask yourself, what's the best way to cut a row-correlated Gaussians? And then what you do ought to do is to say, you to answer yourself, I've actually seen it before. And the best way to do it is, you know, the best way thing I would be able to get is this Arcos rho over pi. That's the best value I'm going to get if I want to cut rho correlated Gaussians. Because this is basically just a special, if you looked at the sphere graph, you could try to cut by basically concentrating on like the first coordinate, that would basically behave like a rho correlated Gaussian. So this is so basically, and this happens to be conveniently our soundness level. So if a function, at least this function, the function that's farthest away from a dictator, is the function that's farthest away from a dictator is basically what it says is that dictator gives you value completeness. And the central limit theorem tells you that democracy gives you value soundness. Okay? And so at least some democracies are sound. So, but what we wanted to say that something that every function that gives you better value better than S plus better than S better than S is somewhat related to a dictator, and this is where we can this is where this invariance principle comes into play. So I'll not tell you define exactly the invariance principle at this point because it's late. But basically, it's a generalization of the central limit theorem. So the central limit theorem basically tells you that if you have independent variables and you take some linear combination of them, and you don't put all the weight on just one of them, but you kind of spread the weight evenly, then you're going to get a Gaussian. The invariance principle tells you that if you apply any polynomial, any, say, low-degree polynomial to a set of variables, and this polynomial is not very correlated with any particular dictatorship, then it would not distinguish, it would not be able to tell apart whether you plug it in independent random variables or you plugged in Gaussians. And when you plug in Gaussians, then the value that this polynomial cuts is basically this value. It's the value that you would get on the sphere graph. So, and the integrality gap guarantees to you that you cannot do better than soundness. So basically the invariance principle tells you to be able to distinguish between the sphere and the cube, you have to be somewhat correlated to a dictator. And that's how this gadget works. So, so I think this is as much as I'm going to say about this proof for tonight. So, questions?
I don't understand in which step you are trying to distinguish sphere and cube.
Right. So you want to say So in the sphere graph, the max cut. In the sphere graph, it's an integrality gap. So here the max cut is at most the soundness level, which is like alpha GW, you know, R cosinus of this thing. So, but there is a pseudo distribution that gives you a value, the completeness level. In the cube graph, there is an actual cut, which gives you the value of the pseudo cuts here. So in the sphere graph, the maximum cut as at most S. The cube graph, you can think of it as a version where you kind of planted cuts that give you the same the pseudo value for the sphere. So if you cut along the coordinate using a dictatorship function, you actually get the value C. So, and what we want to say is basically, if you have a dictatorship function, then it gets a very different value here and here. Because in the sphere it will give you value C, here no function will give you better than value S. if you have a function that's very far from a dictatorship, then it somehow doesn't really know, because it's not particularly, it's a little bit going back to what Pablo said in some sense. It doesn't favor the coordinate basis. If it's a function that's kind of doesn't, it's not close to a dictator, it doesn't really favor the coordinate basis. It doesn't have like anything special. So it's not really going to know if you thread it the cube or the sphere, and therefore it's not going to give max cut better than S. And then that's going to be used in our encoding. So basically the way the reduction will work, we say, okay, we encode a symbol here as the dictatorship, but then we need to decode. So we say, we're going to put a graph here, and if somehow we're going to find a partition that gives better value than the soundness, then for most guys, or at least a good fraction of them, in some sense, the problem we start with will be so good parameters that it's enough that a constant fraction of them, we can find they are somewhat correlated with a dictator, and then we can decode them and get this dictator here and get an assignment that satisfies the original problem. So,
is it true that this only works for degree 2?
So degree 2, in some sense, the fact that it only works for degree 2 is a feature, not a bug.
Okay.
It only needs degree 2. So you know, you get unique game hardness, and you only needed the original integrality gap to be a degree 2 integrality gap. So in some sense, this makes the theorem only stronger, the fact that it only works for degree 2. And whether the right way to make, you know, to get NP hardness is to start with a stronger gap, or to just prove the unique game's conjecture and then immediately unique game hardness is NP hardness, that we still don't know. So it is possible in some sense that this theorem will translate into a way to upgrade automatically any degree 2 gap into a degree million gap. If the unique game's conjecture is true, then we predict that. We don't know how to do that.
So there's no known proof that you recognize from different degrees of SLS to each other.
Not just there is no known proof. There are plenty of problems where we do know of degree 2 gaps, but we don't know of degree 100 gaps. So
including CSPs and things like that.
Including maxcut. So we don't know a degree 100 gap for maxcut. And we somehow know that this particular gap, as it is, cannot be the degree 100 gap. Whether it can be massaged, tensored, flipped around and into a degree 100 gap, that's a great question. And this is a wonderful open problem. Okay. So if there are no more questions, I'll let you go early. I hope you watched the debate. I'm of course completely neutral, but let me just say, made the best woman win.